Just think about the Silk Road crackdown mentioned earlier. The underlying question is always how much government control is necessary and desirable. Bitcoins make it very hard for authorities to track illegal activities, ranging from the funding of terrorists and money laundering to ordering hacking attacks in the deep web. At the same time, however, they enable the funding of independent media in autocratic regimes. Bitcoin's proponents defend it by arguing that it is not the flaws in the technology that nurture its dark side, but abuse by people, UME 2016. They're right in that cash can just as well be used as an instrument for illegal activities, but there is evidence of an extreme correlation between Bitcoin and underground markets, Christine 2013. If banks manage to harness the technology and squeeze it into the corset of current regulation, all the bad aftertaste of the deep web would be swallowed and blockchain could become a force for good. For this to happen, banks need to legitimise it. Again, the silver bullet is centralised blockchains, as the technical setup allows for all necessary controls. This is not to say, however, that Bitcoin and other decentralised applications should be banned. Canada's light-touch approach, discussed in Chapter 2, is a better way to deal with the problem. You cannot control everything on the dark side of the net, but governments must eliminate the possibility of dirty crypto value being brought into the legal system. They could do this by regulating exchanges or even giving them licenses, as well as tracking and analysing monetary movements. The second criticism of the blockchain, that it will slash traditional jobs, cannot be dealt with by regulation. For most of human history, extraordinary economic growth has correlated with automation, but at the same time, automation has had a negative impact on employment levels in the fields it revolutionised. So it's no wonder there's concern about the impact that blockchain could have on current finance jobs.